Anyway, let's move on to other news. The invasion of Ukraine has not been going as Russia might have planned, but I want to put it in perspective because I hadn't really thought about this before. It was raised, there's some discussion, I think on like on MSNBC, some reporter might have mentioned this. Whether you accept Ukraine's numbers on the number of Russian soldiers that have died or the US estimation, the UN estimation, what it looks like at this point, if you sort of split the difference there, because we can't trust any one source for that information wholly, it seems as if Russia might have in 2 weeks lost about a third as many soldiers as they lost in Afghanistan in a decade of war. Urban combat, all that, remember, like if you're not familiar, it was considered a massive quagmire, a massive loss of life and money, a huge debacle for Russia over the course of effectively the 80s roughly. It's been 2 weeks and they're about a third into that. And if this thing doesn't go like from their point of view exactly as they would want in the near future, they will rapidly pass those numbers from Afghanistan. I don't know, does it take a month? Does it take 3 months, 6 months? But it isn't, this is way worse already at this point from Afghanistan. And we'll see if that ends up leading to an opening for diplomacy possibly, but you have got to imagine that in addition to the deaths of multiple generals, the fact that the convoy, by the way, has apparently dispersed. Now, we're gonna show you the satellite photo. Some of the segments of the convoy have gone off to do what they want to do, but there's a ton of left behind, destroyed and abandoned vehicles there. The Russian stock market has been shut down for 11 days. This is a lot of really devastating news that none of this is how it was supposed to go from the point of view of Putin and his inner circle, Brett.
Yeah, we're past the point. So here's what happens in all these discussions is there's a lot of people, there's a lot of folks that are like, all right, well, this would be a failure. And you know, levying some kind of sanctions against the Russian government would be, you know, sanctions are a form of warfare. Yes, and it's less bloody than other kinds of warfare. And I don't know what else you're supposed to do in the meantime, but all the people who are like, you know, who make a living out of, or at least respect themselves enough to criticize Biden, I'll say like, he's doing all right. Like all the, he is not engaging in the stupid petty conversations that are, that they're trying to pull him off toward. He has very silently and effectively navigated for the most part everything about this war that sadly you learn by being in Washington for a billion years, right? Mm-hmm. He's now able to pick up the phone and call. And this is really the only area of effectiveness that kind of experience is worth. And the side of the coin he's on is the opposite of Lindsey Graham's side of the coin, to be frank. Like Lindsey Graham and that kind of hawkish experienced DC insider would have like declared war potentially by now, or at least rattled the saber in a very unsafe way, not to mention ironic from the fact that when you hear Lindsey Graham talk, the last thing you get is scared. Mm-hmm. But to get back to Putin's calculations, I don't think that Ukraine is remotely out of the woods, because one thing, you know, as much as you learn from Afghanistan that they got in a quagmire and they eventually pulled out, the other thing you know about Russian military resolve is they really don't care that much how many of them die.
Yeah, that's devastating. No, and I'm so glad that you're acknowledging that, because like the fact that so many, and by the way, this is in no means to not like to avoid the fact that lots of Ukrainian soldiers and civilians are dying. That's devastating too. Seeing the number of Russian soldiers dying, seeing like every helicopter you see get shot down, every like scorched, discarded tank. Those are soldiers that we have no reason to believe have any interest in this war any more than we would be if we were sent to invade some country. I'm against the people who have led to this invasion, and I'm sure there are some Russians that are totally gung-ho to do it. But lots of them are just kids. They're 17, 18, 19 year old. They're doing what they were told, ordered to do. God only knows what would happen to them if they tried not to. And so this is devastating to see so many dead on both sides that should not have happened.
Everybody's trying to pull these through lines, these ridiculous, tenuous threads. The through line you can pull is in the wake of 9/11, a lot of young Americans signed up for the war and went in a misguided effort in Iraq and Afghanistan and lost their lives, or at least their lives were, in by certain definitions, ruined. And that is a through line you can pull to these Russian folks who have been told that there's an X, like they've been lied to essentially about how they why they would get involved in it. And now they're encountering that and their lives are either lost or ruined in the meantime. Because what are their options? One, to potentially survive and execute this this exercise or this attack. The others are, you know, you get captured, you get killed, you desert your country by definition, but you do it for something that when you get there, you realize is a noble cause. It's just not, you can't go back until there's a completely different regime and attitude back in Mother Russia, or they invent a usable lie. But in the meantime, the amount of lying coming out of the Kremlin is, if you want to be that kind of cynical American, you could say it's on Pentagon levels, if not exceeding them.
Now, I also want to let you know that while things are not going at all well for the Russians, also devastating for the Ukrainians and likely to become more so. Very briefly, some of the vehicles that have branched off from the convoy are now moving into position to be used. There's reports of howitzers and rocket launchers near a couple of different cities. And so those will lead to Ukrainian losses, likely a significant percentage civilian as well. In Mariupol in particular, one of the areas that has been worst besieged in the last week or so, apparently, well, according to a source inside the Ukrainian government, so again, grain of salt, more than 1,300 people have died in just 10 days. Nearly 500,000 people, there's no heat, there's no phone service. For most, there's no electricity. It gets below freezing. Bodies are being buried in mass graves. Absolutely devastating. Again, reminder, when people try to get you to stop thinking about this in terms of the human cost and start getting, well, like there's all these really interesting, sexy conspiracy theories. Let's think about that instead. Remember, those people are suffering, dying, being tossed into mass graves because there's no alternative. That is what they're trying to distract you from. So just bear that in mind.
And all those people will also like harp on privilege. Like there's a term of white privilege. You have like American privilege just to be able to dabble. And these folks specifically have the privilege to be able to dabble in these ridiculous conspiracy theories, and the people there don't.
Yeah. Bear in mind, as the lower third's been alluding to, the WHO says there's been at least 26 attacks on Ukrainian health facilities since the start of the invasion. And bear in mind, lots of conspiracy theories around those as well. Oh no, don't worry about the hospitals being bombed. They weren't hospitals. They were just being taken over by radicals. It's the sort of arguments we see in other conflicts. It's not true there, it's not true here. There's crisis actors. No, it's not true. This whole thing went viral about this woman who was like, "Ooh, did you know that this pregnant woman was an actress?" Yeah, she was an actress. She was also pregnant. That's why she was there. She just gave birth, by the way. Anyway, there's just so much misinformation. Everyone be very careful about who you go to for information like this. In any event, in addition to his earlier comments, Joe Biden today said that the US would welcome Ukrainian refugees, quote, with open arms, which I very much hope turns out to be true, especially since over 2.5 million Ukrainian refugees have already fled in just 2 weeks, that number likely to rise. I'm not 100% sure though. First of all, we are not a country that generally has been all that open to refugees, particularly in the last decade or so. Maybe there will be something different about this conflict. It has captured people's attention. Maybe the Republicans won't like absolutely lose their minds if we suggest bringing in more than 2,000 or 3,000. We'll see. I would also say, as we've been saying from the very beginning, if we are super open and welcoming to Ukrainian refugees, which we very much should be, we should keep that in mind, because this is not the only refugee crisis currently ongoing, let alone what will occur in the next few years. Brett?
I mean, for me, it comes back to, yeah, there's a lot of people and there's some folks in the chat talking about like pleas from other countries for Ukraine to accept Putin's proposal for a ceasefire. But Putin's proposal for a ceasefire is absolutely ridiculous. Like, he invaded the country and he wants Ukraine to demilitarize. Like, you can't do that. Like, you know, give up parts of the country, fine. I don't know, they've been besieged and there's talk about that. Declare a ceasefire, that is what people want. But Putin's like, all right, cool. So next thing you do for peace sake is get rid of all weapons, trust me. Like, we can't do that. And that's the only thing that I think, you know, if as we're doing, there's gonna be more talks on Monday, a third round. So we'll see how that goes, but that's where we're at.
Yeah. Anyway, but really fast, just because I found this to be fascinating. Meta, which I hate calling it that, it's Facebook. Don't let them hide all of the terrible things that they've done, the horrible policies, the benefiting financially off the spreading of hate and misinformation by hiding behind a different name. What are they, a private military? They just shift their name? It's Facebook. Anyway, they're temporarily gonna allow users in some countries to post hateful comments against Russian attackers in Ukraine, against Putin himself, as well as the president of Belarus, Alexander Lukashenko. They'll allow posts containing death threats against Putin and Lukashenko unless they reference other individuals or are deemed to be credible threats of actual violence with specifics like place and time. That is amazing. They specifically, okay, here are a couple of leaders you can advocate for the murder of. Does that not seem a little bit weird, Brett?
It is just at every turn they make a stupid decision. Mm-hmm. It's okay for you to keep banning death threats. That's it. Mm-hmm. Like, that's okay. You can do it. But it's just this detached, like, I know these folks. It's this detached, weird, neoliberal, elitist, and I always call it District One. It's very Hunger Games District One. It's folks being like, I'm just a worldly human being who understands plights and I'm so sensitive and great. Anyways, can you please turn down your music and your complaining because I need to go to hot yoga in 5 minutes. Mm-hmm. That's how it is. Just a really thoughtful, touching, inspirational Instagram message over a photo that looks like it's done by Ansel Adams, but really it's from their front porch because they live in Shangri-La and they have no real connection to these human beings, though they think they do. And that's actually the most dangerous part of it.
Yeah, it's so weird. Like, I get the anger, I get that. Is this supposed to be setting a precedent for what, future conflicts, future, like, who will be added to the, like, the kill list next that you can advocate for the, I don't know.
The decision's made after a meeting where they each like take a some kind of ball that they pass around, the idea ball that the other idea ball person gets to give. They don't call them bad ideas and change, they don't call them negatives from the old idea, they call them deltas. Things we'd like to change because we don't want any negativity here.
Check out the Damage Report podcast each day, wherever you get your podcasts, whether Pocket Casts or Stitcher or iTunes. You can join me as I give you the news and stories you want with a range of co-hosts and interview guests jumping in on the fun each day. Again, that's the Damage Report, wherever you get your podcasts. And if you get them at iTunes, don't forget to rate and review. Sometimes I'll read them live on the show.